For those who don't know me, my name is Noah Brown. I'm a 17-year-old exploring interior arts design. Next year, I will be attending the last year of high school at the Togo School of the Arts as a visual arts major. I'm currently preparing for my student portfolio day, which is an event where representatives from universities from all over the world come to critique and offer scholarships. I would like to thank Carolyn T for offering her expertise in gospel singing and giving us a wholesome experience of Black sound.
Today, I talked about being an androgynous boy in a Black community, as well as the current psychological state of Black boys, them seeing things in society that's telling them to be unemotional, aggressive, and non-expressive, I suppose.
I would lastly like to thank Anne Hines and the United Church for seeing the potential in my art and providing a space for me to produce my biggest project today. It is with much gratitude that I've been given an opportunity to discuss the importance of Black history. While exploring current issues, thanks to the love and support of this community. Recently, I've discovered an interest in dry felt illustration. I produced 3 6x6 feet blankets regarding issues related to the identity of adults and Black boys. The first blanket that I produced was a self-portrait focusing on Black boys and the sense of vulnerability attached to living outside of gender norms, which presents a great argument. This project stemmed from a personal experience in which I was verbally attacked on a public transit. This attack wasn't like any other altercation I've experienced in my life, mostly due to the fact that it was enacted by boys my age who looked just like me. I was targeted simply because I was wearing a likely hoodie that they thought was too gay, and continued to make homophobic remarks on the bus. After the verbal attack took place, I was left with anger, confusion, and recurring questions. Why did they call me these names? Aren't they aware that their ancestors were labeled as niggers? And why can't they empathize with the LGBT's constant oppression? I already knew the answer, or at least the most sensible source for their ignorant behavior. Yes, they can understand the gravity of that emotional that can happen in a person, but that this is the way in which they are taught that strong Black boys should behave. After finishing this blanket, I then went on to working on my second blanket called Nails, which is an illustration of my painted nails, which is presented in the back right beside the hood boy. In this illustration, I'm concealing my painted nails. I find that I often have to hide my androgynous features from other Black boys, as they will see it as a weakness. In many Black cultures, such as the large population of Canadian Jamaicans, including myself, there's a homophobic mentality instilled within the culture. According to Dr. Anakin Marshall, this hatred towards members of the LGBT community stems from an enormous social pressure to conform to cultural and religious expectations about masculinity and femininity. I was then inspired to work on my third blanket when I conversed with my sister Marley, who's somewhere in the crowd. She introduced the idea that the boy who attacked me could have possibly been struggling with his own sexuality. I then discussed the psychology behind the boy's actions with my lifelong friend, Nico Savaria. In the past, Nico has done social work with struggling youth, and we come to find out that mostly young men have dysfunctional relationships with their fathers, and that they would attack people with the thought of their absent fathers in mind. The source of the boy's thoughts remains unknown, but it is certain that it derived from a place of insecurity. In the third blanket, which is presented in 7 days, the hooded boy has prominent red lipstick on his lips. This specific cosmetic appearance signifies the hidden insecurities of those who crown people that express themselves freely. I felt the message behind this blanket was important due to the fact that our surrounding media presents the image of Black boys as unemotional, aggressive, and dangerous. Boys of color are often left with emotionally and physically damaging expectations of norms for their racial role. In this, it's then more logical as to why these expectations might contradict a boy who wishes to further express himself. Depending on the outfit that I wear on a specific day, I can see the significant difference of time I'm treated and then perceived with baggy clothes on compared to when I'm wearing a formal uniform. This piece also represents the population of Black youth that are in the stage of deciding whether or not they want to live above their predecessors or follow their path. While there are successful Black boys to look up to, living as a Black boy, I came to find many people that I looked up to as a kid, or even childhood friends, eventually chose dangerous lifestyles to gain a sense of comfort from following the racial stereotypes. In art school, I'm prompted to deconstruct my life and bring hidden aspects about my character to the surface. My previous blankets focused on my personal issues with self-identity, along with the current psychological state of Black boys. I then felt the need to research the intergenerational trauma that has impacted the Black community, and specific details about my people's history. Finding specifications about my culture is an important part of connecting with my background, since all recorded history of my ancestors was erased during slavery. All that I'm left with is stories and speculations, but what I do know is that my Jamaican background derives from the Maroon tribe, a group of escaped slaves who were able to build a community in the mills of Jamaica out of the enslaver's reach. They were also the first collective of liberated slaves to sign a treaty with the English Empire. After more than 300 years of slavery, my Maroon heritage is the only information that I have left of my origin. This made me want to look further into the journey of my ancestors and how they were forcefully migrated into foreign lands. For my most recent project, I chose to build a 4x17 feet replication of the slave ship, which is laid down here. This dry-felt illustration is based on the architectural structure of the notorious Brooks slave ship, which would hold 250 to 600 slaves. That's a big number. The maximum amount of space given to an adult male was less than a meter squared, which you can imagine is under the space required for an adult human alone. Spaces dedicated to children were placed separately from the rest of the adults. And also another thing is the technique of how I felt things is I take a synthetic felt and then I put I use wool for the actual illustration. And then you sort of connect the fibers when you're punching the fabric into the palm of your hand. And this process is quite painful because it's done with a needle with little ridges at the side, which I occasionally stab myself, but it's the sacrifice you take to make bigger ideas. All the information that I have mentioned is traumatic and challenging the process, but it is the only thing that I have left. And with this troubling information, I plan to articulate with compassion. My art is a continuous search of ways to educate and better my culture. I'm thankful for all the assistance that my art teacher, Mr. Berry, has given me throughout my artistic journey, and I acknowledge his support in each and every piece I produce. Give a round of applause for Mr. Berry. Okay, well, thank you all for listening, and I hope you learned something from this talk, and I hope you all have a lovely day. And this means that I have to print out all the slaves that are currently like on this sling board. So that means that I have to have one of my hands and to count out which one I have for a row. So say one row has 14 slaves. I have to take from a pile and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then I had a realization that that I guess that's how they thought of just as numbers, and it's a very shocking experience for me. I then also, when looking at the paper, it's sort of weird looking. I had a weird moment where I put the paper up to the light just because I was trying to count which ones. And sort of when you make printer copy sort of pictures of just black, there would be parts of the face where, or at least the face on the outline where the ink will be unequal, so the light will shine through differently, so it almost makes faces. It's a very haunting experience to look at that. Yeah.
And maybe something else to that, but have you had any connection that moved you down?
Yes.
What does it feel like to bring down on the floor?
It feels, I don't know if I could really put it into words, but it's horrifying and it's scary that was their entire life. Like, you can imagine that we're able to come to this church today and be able to talk about such horrible things in the past, but for them, this was literally their entire life. They don't even know that there will be a time where people will be free, and that's very important.
You're not. When Noah first showed me his work before he came, I said that I'm so struck both by the pain in it, the edginess in it, the absolute hard truth in it, but also by the deep love in it. That thing that every single one of your pieces. Is there a way to love in this?
Well, I feel like the process of like loving with such like a horrible thing is, I guess, like the best form is education and ensuring that this won't happen again. And sort of seeing this happening in Charlottesville is very scary because it's a reality, like this is happening and people are trying to make sort of the nonsense reality, the slavery reality, like happen once more. So we really have to fight against that. People with all the privilege have to fight against that. Ensure that it never happens again.
Does anyone have a question for Noah? Yes, Kathy.
Well, yeah, as I mentioned before, like it's not guilt that we need, it's action. So I guess the best thing is just to educate yourself. That's the first goal. So that's making sure that you know public figures, political figures, historical figures of the Black community. That's the first step, because there's so many people in my school, not necessarily school, I guess age group, where I go to events and they don't know who Malcolm X is, they don't know who Martin Luther King is, Black history going on, they don't know who these important characters are, and that's the first step to really getting somewhere above where we are right now, is really acknowledging the past and improving off of that. So I'd say the first step is education, and the second step is to make sure that that you try to improve other people's behavior. So say your friend makes a comment that you find is a little bit off and it's not politically correct, then you ensure that they understand that the true value of what they're saying. Some people still don't know that, for instance, some people still don't know that the term Eskimo is actually offensive. It means the wrong eater, if I'm correct. And it's almost equivalent to nigger. So we need to improve in that as a nation because we're still coming in that, and the proper terms to do it. But yeah, I'd say education and educating others. There's some people who simply are too far that you won't improve because they've been wrong like that. So, and that's saddening, but it's the sad reality. And then lastly, just spreading love. That's all I'd say.
It was amazing to see people really questioning and asking about the Black reality and me educating them and them educating me. Eventually overcame my fear because I just sort of saw my surroundings and felt more comfortable to talk.
Now, as I stand here and as I sat here listening to you, I'm suddenly struck by seeing this piece together with this piece. Both of these pieces express a really hard truth, a deep, deep pain, which is almost unfathomable of someone who carried that pain and still. But both of these pieces provide us with such an opportunity to crack open, to love more, to commit ourselves to a different way of being. I feel, in fact, as if we have created something that your ancestors are able to speak to this world, to this person, and say, you have our strength, you have our courage, but you will live a life that we can only have dreamed of. And you will create for us a world that we right now hope and pray for.
It's important that we're educated about Black history to stay knowledgeable of what has happened in the past, and then also make sure that we never repeat history once more, and that we treat each other with compassion, and we just make sure that the world's a better place and spread love.